Hello and welcome everyone to another Saturday radiology session by Team Radio Gyan. Today's session is by Dr. Sikandar. It's going to be on the basics of PET-CT. Dr. Sikandar is a consultant radiologist at Yashoda Hospital, Hyderabad. He's also an adjunct professor of in the Department of Biomedical Engineering at IIT Hyderabad. Along with that, he's also an assistant professor at the Department of Radiology at Shadan Medical College, in Hyderabad, India. Along with his academic, his ton of academic positions, he also holds a lot of positions in the national and international radiology boards, including a lot of journals, ICRI, and even ESHI. He's also a research committee member of the ESOI. He's the education committee member of SPR, that's the Society of Pediatric Radiology. He's president elect for ISMRM. So, and the list goes on and on. So along with his academics, he's also very keen on teaching, and he has also collaborated with a lot of radiologists and started a teaching venture for residents, which is called Radiology Clinics. You can check up or you can join the group on Telegram, where he regularly conducts webinars and teaching sessions. So without wasting any further time, I'm sure if we discuss all of Dr. Sikandar's accolades, it's going to take ages. We'll start the lecture. Over to you, Dr. Sikandar.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, and welcome everyone for this excellent venture which is started by Dr. Amar. So it's like very few people they venture in the sort of teaching selflessly, and I have noticed Dr. Amar is one of the and having excellent means huge number of people who are following your group, your YouTubes, and all that, and you are conducting a quality teaching sessions, and hopefully these are very, very helpful to all the residents. So thank you, Dr. Amar, for inviting me. And thank you all attendees. So hopefully I will try to screen share and try to start my presentation. Is it visible?
It is.
Yeah. So my today's topic is on PET-CT basics. So before starting a brief, what exactly is PET? So PET, we all know it is one of the important established modality. And most important, it is one of the initial and the first presumed to be imaging modality of molecular imaging. And we all know the molecular imaging as defined by the Society of Nuclear Medicine, SNM, is the visualization, characterization, and measurement of biological processes at the molecular and cellular levels in humans and other living systems. So now molecular imaging is comprised of multiple imaging modalities, which are based on 2D or 3D imaging or acquisitions, then interaction with the cellular or subcellular processes at these levels. Then there are a lot of things which can have an enzymatic modification of receptor bindings. Then you have SPECT-CT, PET-CT, radiolabel probes, biochemical reactions in the region of interest. And as I told you, it has become a multimodality now. Initially, we started with the PET, but a lot of things are coming because of advancement in the techniques, technology, radioisotopes, biomarkers, and so many things which are coming in future. Probably this is one of the first step for the beginning of the precision medicine, where we refer it as a personalized medicine. So if you see this, you have ultrasound, you have MR, you have optical imaging, SPECT, PET-CT, PET-MR, probes and imaging of molecular interaction, nano imaging, stem cell imaging, and genetic or gene imaging. So the basis of this molecular imaging is visualization of cellular function by using the various molecular processes. And the most important component or entity here in molecular imaging is without disturbing the tissues or cells. That is very, very important. Surrounding tissues you should not disturb. Otherwise, it will have an impact on the imaging as well as the morbidity of that particular patient. So there are a lot of things which are coming here. So coming dot to the PET CT, we all know PET is a positron emission tomography and CT is a computed tomography. So it is a combination of functional as well as anatomical imaging. And thus it is a metabolic imaging technique that uses a radio labeled analog of glucose or any other metabolites as their utilization is increased in malignancies. And CT, we all know, it is a tomographic imaging technique that has using an X-ray beam to produce the anatomical images. And the importance of anatomical information is for detecting, determining the location and extent of the malignancies. So what exactly is a positron emission? So it is also known as beta plus decay. And it is an isobaric decay process by which a proton inside the radionuclide nucleus is converted into neutron. So nucleus is converted into neutron by releasing a positron and a neutrino. So this is a decay process which happens, and it is a characteristic of protein-rich radionuclides. So in this process, the element with an atomic number that is less by one unit, the nuclear transmutation, that is the conversion of one chemical element or isotope into another. So isobaric decay process, the mass number of a daughter nuclei, which remains the same in the parent, but the atomic number changes. So this is one of the important thing which happens in isobaric decay. So the mass number of the daughter nuclei remains the same in parent, but the atomic number changes. So PET is positron emission tomography. And the basis of this is like having a detectors. We all know in CT, we are having detectors to detect the signals. And that is how the image is being formed. So in PET, you are having scintillators. So scintillators are the backbone of the PET image where you can easily try to acquire the image and then the images are formed. So these scintillators are based on different chemical components. You have thallium, you have bismuth, you have gadolinium oxyorthosilicate, but the common and most widely used worldwide in majority of the vendors is lutetium oxyorthosilicate. So coming to emitters now, you have positron, you have emitters. So what exactly is it? You need a radioisotope. So this principle, this modality is based on the radioisotope which will be injected. So the moment the radioisotope comes, it will have definitely an half-life. So half-life is one of the important characteristic feature of any radioactive material. What exactly is it? So half-life means the component, physical component of that particular element will become exactly half in the size or the quantum in a particular period of a time is known as half-life. So this is very important. And there are different isotopes which are being used in PET. They are 18 fluorine, which has a half-life of 110 minutes, 11 carbon having 20 minutes, nitrogen 13 has 10 minutes, 15 oxygen has 2 minutes. Now, just one point I want to make an important here aspect is the half-life should be reasonable, so that whenever a radioisotope is being injected in the body, it should get circulated in the body. Second, it should get deposited in the area of interest or region of interest or a particular abnormal pathological tissue like malignancy or infection, so that this accumulation of the radio tracers can be used to determine and detect the pathology in this PET imaging. So the PET positron emission, so it is more prevalent in lower atomic weight nuclei, like you have 11 carbon, 13 nitrogen, 15 oxygen, and 18 fluorine. So lower atomic nuclei are more prevalent having this property of emission. And the electron capture is a predominant mode of decay in iodine-123. So if you see the common positron emitters, if you see with the lower number, and these are with the higher numbers. So this is like already we have seen. Now you are having seen the half-life and the energy, that is MeV energy, which is being released. So it is optimal here. So if you see the half-life is 24, 20 minutes, 10 minutes, 2.1 minute, 110 minute. So ideally, the more comfortable injectable positron emitter is 18 fluorine. So it has a very good half-life and the amount of energy is not too high. And the daughter is 18 oxygen. So the beta percentage emission is coming to close to 97. So this is one of the important. Another, if you go to the gallium, which has a half-life of 68 minutes, this is also there, but the maximum energy MeV is around 1.89. So it is on a higher side. So how the PET scanner is being designed? So the, as I told you, the basic component of the PET is the small detectors, and these are placed in adjacent rings around the patient. So the PET system has a ring diameter of 60 to 90 centimeters, an axial element of 10 to 25 centimeters. So thus, it consists of up to 25,000 detectors. So if you see this, this is LSO array. So these are multiple LSO array crystals. So this is one crystal, another crystal. So they are compacted. Together, they are forming a LSO array. Down, you are having avalanche photodiodes. So these are the photodiodes, which are integrated with the cooling channels. Because any sort of activity will be releasing a huge amount of heat, and this needs to be cooled. So that is the reason you have integrated cooling channels here. And you have 3x3 APD array, and then you have pre-amplifier board and a driver board at the bottom of this. So this is a detector assembly with the avalanche photodiodes. So avalanche photodiodes are most widely used in the recent machines or newer machines. So coming to detector assembly with the silicon photomultiplier tubes. So this is a silicon photomultiplier tube with a circuit boards. So this is there. So you have thermal coupling gasket, you have aluminum mounting plate, then you have light tight RF shield with the copper coating. So now if you see the single PET detector, so it is a high density scintillating crystal. So which is made up of bismuth, germanium, oxyorthic or lutetium, yttrium, oxy, orthosilicate or lutetium, yttrium, orthosilicate. But the most commonly used, I told you, is LSO. And the principle here is there is a conversion of the energy of photons which are striking the detector into the light. So thus, scintillator is optically coupled to a device which is known as photomultiplier tube. So light is converted into amplifier electrical signal, and these signals from each detector are coupled to a coincident circuit that tags each PET event by the detection time. So thus, photons detected within the coincidence window of the systems accepted as coincidence events and assigned to the LOR connecting the two detectors. So rest other events are all rejected. So each tomographic slice, so images and the depiction of the diagram is there in coming slice. Just remember this, each tomographic slice can be reconstructed independently by only accepting LOR within the given slice. And the independent reconstruction can be obtained by inserting septa, that is thin lead or tungsten collimating rings between crystal rings, such that inter-ring coincidences are prevented. And this method of imaging is called 2D PET. So it is much higher sensitivity obtained if the inter-ring coincidences are accepted, and mode of imaging is termed as a 3D PET. So you have 2D as well as 3D PET. So what exactly is it? So 2D, we all imagine, we all know it is two-dimensional, and 3D is three-dimensional. But here, as far as the resolution, the image formation, the clarity of the image, obviously we think that 3D is better than the PET and then the 2D. But simpler data handling and image reconstruction has to be also kept in mind. So there is evolvement of faster computers for this, then development of better iterative reconstruction methods are there. And there is a gain sensitivity from 3D PET versus 2D PET. And this has led to the formation of a better 3D PET. And this is a more preferred in imaging modalities. So with this, more than 99% of all 511 kV photon interactions in the PET Compton scattering That is, the inelastic scattering of photons on effective free electrons is seen, and this process is resulting in the production of the new photons. So before going to exactly what happens and how it happens technically, the other side of the story, the basics of the PET, technical machines, the other side of the story is the important aspect is the metabolisms in the body. So how we are going to use, how our body is being utilized by the concept of metabolism. The moment metabolism comes, we know the basic three metabolisms that happen in our body are carbohydrate, second is protein, and third is fat metabolism. But most common is glucose metabolism. And that has formed the basis of the recently available FDG molecule, that is fluorodeoxyglucose molecule, because the glucose is most widely used metabolic component in the body. But down the line in future, down the line, there are a lot of new radiotracers which are coming, because the glucose FDG sensitivity is not 100% in majority of tumors, then certain molecular biomarkers are being more precise so that the particular radiotracer can be used to evaluate that particular pathology. And the excellent example is a dopamine or dopaminergic pathway for Parkinson's disease. So with this, there is a concept of overexpression of various receptors, increased blood flow and vascularization, and you have decreased oxygen tension in some cancers, and thus increase apoptosis with the successful therapy. So now coming, already I told you the most widely used metabolic component is the glucose, and that is why it is most widely used. But there are other things which are in pipeline. So like methionine, tyrosine, acetate, and palmitate are also being used. Now, what is FDG actually? So FDG is the fluorodeoxyglucose. So the tumors consume more glucose than most other tissues. This is basic principle. So increased glycolysis is also known as Warburg's effect, and thus PET using FDG as a radiotracer makes sense. So thus FDG, what is it? It is radiolabeled glucose analog, and 20-hydroxyl group has been substituted with the 18-fluorine. So this is the FDG. It is a metabolic contrast agent, half-life of 110 minutes, and very safe, no side effects. It's just sugar. And the FDG uptake in tumor cells is a marker of tumor glycolysis. And 18F is still the backbone of PET radiochemistry. And 18-fluorine is produced in a cyclotron by the process of nuclear reaction. And between oxygen 18, that is 18 oxygen, which is enriched water bombarded with the protons, releasing a neutron according to the production equation of 18 oxygen and 18 fluorine. So long half-life of 110 minutes. So the ideal FDG is very important because it has a very long half-life of 110 minutes. It allows synthesis and studies that can be extended over hours and transferred to distant centers. And it has a low positron energy, that is 640 kV, resulting in short tissue range and resulting in a higher resolution and lower radiation dose. And 18F advantages are over the short-lived radioisotopes for rendering metabolite and plasma analysis. And there is a quantification and dynamic studies which can be possible. Now coming to exactly what happens here. So this is a FDG molecule where OH is replaced by fluorine. So it becomes fluorodeoxyglucose, and this injected in the body. In the body, patient is lying down. This is a PET gantry here, and you are having PET scintillators which are moving around the patient. So these scintillators will detect this energy which is being released at 180 degrees based on Einstein's principle. So that's how this energy will be picked up by both the scintillators exactly opposite at 180 degrees, and thus there is a formation of an uncorrected image. So this is uncorrected image which is formed purely by the PET. So it has to be fused with the CT, and attenuation correction has to be done so that this uncorrected image will become the corrected image. So you have, this is PET scanner, same thing. So I told you this is 180 degrees. This is a tumor in a patient, this is patient couch, and these are all the detectors which are surrounding the patient. So you have 18 fluorine, which has a scantiness to decay into 18 oxygen. So that is giving energy at 180 degrees to each other in a form of positron electron annihilation process. And this annihilation process will result in high energy annihilation photons. So this is a PET scanner, which I told you, and these are the multiple blocks of scintillating crystals. So this is one, two, three, so it becomes a block. So these are the blocks which are seen. Here you have single detector element. So it is a single block of scintillation. So this is a single block, and this is a single detector element within this block. So thus, the scintillation crystals filled with the reflective material can be seen. And PMT is a photomultiplier tube here. So this is a depiction of one component, one block is in this way. So this one block is comprised of scintillating crystals, detector element, and this crystal should be filled with reflective material. I told you what exactly happens in the PET. So how the radioisotope is being produced. So it is produced in a cyclotron. What exactly is it? It is an self-heated compact negative ion accelerator where there is a production of radio tracers. And this is energy which is different for different elements or the metals or the radioisotopes. So FDG and other radioisotopes are also being evaluated. And this is the inner structure of the explora, that is a cyclotron by which the radio tracers can be produced. Now coming to the basic of the FDG. FDG is also an important component as most widely used radio tracer in the world. So here it is injected supine. Then you have approximate 60 minutes prior to the study. And there is a relaxation to minimize the glucose metabolic activity, not to speak, muscle relaxant. Patient is allowed to pass urine before scan because this will further reduce the radioactivity to the urinary bladder, arms up position. Then it can also be scanned with the arms down position, and CT beam hardening artifacts, effects on reconstructed PET images can be done. Now, what are the prerequisites here? What are the important aspects which you should keep in mind? Patient preparation, fasting 4 to 6 hours, no consumption of even beverages. Blood sugar should be less than 150. If it is more, usually you have to defer it. But in cases of emergency, then probably insulin can be given and the radio and the blood sugar level can be reduced to 150. So diabetes needs special instructions. No physical activity, IV injection of FDG, scan starts after 45 minutes of post-injection, and patient not allowed to do anything. Parenteral feeding can be withheld and to check the renal parameters. So this is a cell where you are having a metabolic activity. So this is a FDG which enters the particular cell through the glucose-glycose transporters. And that is a transporter where this is get trapped in the cell. And that is how the radioactive isotope is getting significantly in within the cell. So these are well-differentiated tissue cells and these are proliferating tumors. So in the normal tissues, you have oxygen, then glucose, pyruvate, and this is a cycle which leads to anaerobic glycolysis. But if you are having proliferating tumor cells here, so plus or minus O2, then glucose, it is more interacting, and here pyruvate is there, and the routine glycolytic procedure is not that much correctly performed. And that is how all these things will result in a lactate. So this is a blood and this is a cell. You have blood-brain barrier somewhere here. So FDG is there, FDG, then glucose is there. So this is a mechanism of FDG uptake in a normal tumor cell where 6P FDG is not being converted into glycolysis. So this glycolysis will lead to glucose 6-phosphatase, so which is being seen within the cell. So here, what is the acquisition modes here? You are having whole body tumor imaging from top of it to the feet, accepted and presently followed protocol and most widely used in the world is skull-based to mid-thigh tumor imaging. Limited area imaging, that is a brain, heart, prosthetic joints, both lower limbs as well as upper limb. And the sequence of events in PET is tomogram, CCT or any CT followed by PET scan. So this is one of the important basic component of the PET. If you see, this is a topogram of the PET patient here. But if you see, there are multiple boxes which are overlapping each other and they are covering each other. So what is the concept here now? So when there is an overlap, probably this is the area of overlap. And when there is a reconstruction happening, so probably this will result in the reconstruction algorithm. So Here, the bed position is 6 to 7 based on the height of a patient. The higher the taller, the more the amount of radioactivity needed, and the dose is 0.21 millicurie per kg of FDG. So here, 1 minute to 4 minute scans are usually done in the bed positions. So this is a CT gantry, this is a PET gantry. First CT is being done, then after that patient moves forward, then PET is being done. So these two images, CT as well as PET, will get fused to the, these images are getting fused by the algorithms, and there is a problem of attenuation correction which needs to be taken care before the patient is being discharged. So this is the one of the most important radioactive component is the technological advances in the PET CT. So before starting, we all know any parameter has to be quantified. So this quantification of this standardized uptake value is by the various values. So if you see less than 2.5, so it is definitely a very less uptake, and 2.5 to 4 is a borderline uptake, and 4 and above is definitely more going in a favor of high uptake, that is malignancies. So dual point time imaging here, I just want to stress one important aspect here. After doing the routine PET scan, then the delayed scan is being done after 1 hour or 2 hours of the basic scan, which is being done. So here the concept of dual point is the increased radiotracer activity in a tissue and has to be differentiated between non-malignant or benign or infective pathologies versus malignant pathologies. So these values are very, very important. These are semi-quantitative values, and this has to be kept in as a reference for discriminating and evaluating and diagnosing the various parameters of the particular tissue. So now SUV is based on region of interest. So you have a region of interest. Then the amount of activity which is injected. So if you inject less amount of activity, suboptimal activity, then it is again variable. The results of the uptake are not going to correct. Then third is plasma glucose levels, very important, as the FDG will be competing with the glucose. Then competition with the endogenous glucose. So once injected, again, this will be competing with the endogenous glucose within the cells. And the rate of phosphorylation, body size, body composition, and tumor size. So technically, SUV values, depending on the PET scan, sign SNR, then accuracy of the image reconstruction algorithm, correction algorithms, and time between injection and the image acquisition. So these are a couple of things, just basics. You don't need to go in detail. Just remember various applications of PET CT. The four most common, most widely used is for oncology. Many literatures and that they are between 80 to 90% of indications are only from oncology, and rest is from cardiology, neurology, infection, inflammation, and miscellaneous newer indications like pyrexia of unknown origin or joint processes. So this is how we have already seen this label, and this is also there. Now, another important entity is the oncological indications here, where you have to distinguish between the various tumors, and most important is the unknown primary. We don't know primary is there. So only diagnosed possible things are the unknown primary with the diagnosed metastatic tumor. So all the tumors of the entire body are being used and can be used for diagnosis, staging, restaging, then monitoring response to therapy, guided biopsies, radiotherapy planning, and other miscellaneous various applications which have come. Now coming to neurology indications, you have neuro-oncology, where tumor recurrence versus radiation necrosis is there. For diagnosis, grading, staging, restaging, monitoring response to treatment is there. Then you have seizure focus identification, dementias, and other applications. So thus you have brain injury related, psychiatry, movement disorders, and miscellaneous, and also in cases of substance or drug abuses. So we all know PET-CT is well established for various applications, serious, several infection, inflammation, pyrexia of unknown origin, and various spondylitis and vasculitis. And FDG PET is promising because of bacteremia of unknown origin, prosthetic infections, sarcoid, inflammatory bowel disease, rheumatoid arthritis, psoriasis, and venous thromboembolism. So these are one of the promising indications of FDG PET in coming years. So again, you have potential novel applications where you can diagnose psoriasis, rheumatoid arthritis, inflammatory conditions of skin, inflammatory arthritis, psoriatic arthritis. And they all showed that FDG PET-CT can visualize arthritic joints and endless in both patients and with symptomatic and joint-wise asymptomatic psoriasis. This is a 3D depiction of the lung where a 61-year-old chronic smoker is seen. If you see the paucity of the uptake in this area of interest is because of significant COPD changes. So pyrexia of unknown origin is one very important indication now. It has been more commonly being used in most of the parts of the world, and it is defined as a recurrent fever of 38.2 degrees or higher, lasting 2 to 3 weeks or longer, and undiagnosed after 1 week of hepatic evaluation. So you have heterogeneous group of diseases, 200 potential diagnoses, differential diagnoses, and the causes of pyrexia of unknown origin can be divided into four major groups in a form of infection, malignancies, miscellaneous, and non-infectious inflammations. So these are more commonly seen in immunocompromised patients and during the neutropenic stage of chemotherapy, as well as patients infected with human immunodeficiency virus. And conventional diagnostics are often not sensitive to identify each and every cause. So if you see the overview of FUO, so this is the literature says here. So there are so many things, and ultimately there is no final diagnosis in majority of the researchers who are doing the research on this topic. Now you have post-ATT, one or two examples I'm just showing because this is very important. And there is a blend of multiple normal cases which we need to differentiate before labeling it at any sort of a pathological entity. So you have post-ATT here, bilateral lung, pulmonary cox, no significant uptake. So focal pleural thickening, fibrotic strands, peribronchial thickening, and related with the bronchiectatic changes. So this is another important indication of the left hemipelvis, the Paget's disease, which will show a different approach on the CT. So you have infected knee prosthesis here, where there is a collection fluid here in this area, causing significant artifacts in vicinity. So there are many physiological uptakes which you should remember. These are very basics actually. So if you see this, you have normal physiological uptake here. Nothing is there, no lesion, no nothing absolutely. It is a reactive changes. So normal brain parenchyma, you are having cortex, subcortical region, then deep white matter. So this is a normal brain parenchyma. This is a fused images. These are the non-fused images, only PET images. So another important aspect, if you see the normal, if you see there is nothing here, but if you see the entire colon shows a diffuse activity. So this is because of normal physiological uptake in the bowel, which shows and has to be differentiated from the various malignant conditions. So this is one of the very, very important entity, brown fat uptake. So this is a brown fat, which is more prominent in winters because of increased metabolism in the winters. So this leading and has to be differentiated from the cervical lymphadenopathy. So this is another case which shows a thymic tissue here, anterior mediastinum, which was nothing significant, no mass lesion. So this is a normal thymic tissue. So this is another case of diffuse bone marrow uptake. So this is a bone marrow uptake, which shows a significant uptake in the both kidneys as well as the visualized bone. So it is diffuse reactive changes which are happening. Now, if you see, there is a focal area of uptake in the bilateral walls of oropharynx in the tonsillar region, tonsillar fossa. So this tonsillar fossa will give the rest of the body is entirely normal. So you have to be very careful in analyzing the importance of the particular pathologies or physiology as well. Now, there are a couple of mimics which I want to show. This is important because you should know that this is normal bowel, which was a focal area of uptake in this. If you see, this is corresponding with this. There is no wall thickening, no mass lesion. Rest of the body, absolutely normal. Patchy areas of sclerosis seen involving the left iliac bone at the level of sacroiliac joint. So this is another one where the normal cardia is there. So cardia, more activity because the heart is beating every time. It cannot be stopped. So there is a significant increase activity also seen on exertion. And that is how the FDG is being more widely used. So this is a oropharynx, what we have seen, tonsillar fossa, this is a skull, this is a faint liver here, both kidneys, the pelvic caliceal system is there, then you have urinary bladder. So this is a normal physiological uptake of the cortex, subcortical region, CT brain is absolutely normal, PET is absolutely normal. The issue comes only in relation with the fused PET MR images, which show subtle areas of focal uptake, which is seen in left frontal lobe. So probably this is more favor in relation with the transmission. So this is another case, normal, absolutely here. The spleen is there on this side, both kidneys and liver. So the amount of uptake or SU max looks near about same in all these scenarios. Another one is the focal end on of the vascular structure, which can be misdiagnosed as a SPN or small parenchymal nodule. So this is another case which has been taken from the world because of the patient height, but here the focal area of uptake which is seen in the left heel is pathological and goes more for favor of any viral infections. So this is another one which shows an uptake in the oropharyngeal wall in the anterior aspect, which is showing significant uptake. So this is a normal physiological. So another one where you have both ovaries here, this shows more amount of an uptake. This is a ovary with a thin wall. So here nothing is there. So it is going more in a favor of physiological progress of the cyst or follicle, which is being seen. So this is another one which shows a heterogeneous, mildly bulky with associated presacral soft tissue component. So this is the same image in a different color coding. So this is a patchy sclerosis which happened in the right sacral ala, no uptake, so going in a favor of a sclerotic lesion in the bone. So here another one, I have already shown you the role of PET here, it can be misdiagnosed because there is thinning, there is irregularity of the left half of the descending thoracic aorta. So this is another one which shows diffuse uptake. Always remember there is a minimal amount of background activity in the liver as well as the spleen. And this is a renal pelvic caliceal system. Then you have this important aspect here. So this is not pathological. And you have this thyroid. So again, thyroid means query possibility of thyroiditis cannot be ruled out. So this is another case which shows a focal area of uptake here, probably related with the inflammatory processes which is going on. So this is another case which shows a testicle here, significant uptake, but it is not pathological. So this is the entire lungs are normal. So there is nothing pathology, no other findings which we can suggest any particular amount of the radiotracer or the contrast. So these are the fluorinated radiotracers having a big line. So huge, lot of new things are coming in future. So for the more precise and applications of the precision medicine. So we all know the PET agents other than full fluorine with the potential to monitor. Then you have biological targets of tracers, that is radio tracers of DNA synthesis, PET imaging of hypoxia, amino acids for PET imaging, and imaging of the androgen and estrogen receptors. So these are new radio tracers which are coming here. Just remember, probably in coming days, there will be more disease-specific radiotracers which will be giving. And one of the important example is the DOPA. So DOPA is an alternative to FDG, that is fluorodeoxyglucose. And it is a form of an amine where it can be used to trace apoid metabolisms or catechol amine metabolisms. So this is pertaining to the DOPA. Again, DOPA has another indications like your neuroendocrine tumors, pheochromocytoma, paraganglioma. So this is related with the DOTA now. So DOTA is DOTA knock or DOTA talk. So most commonly used in the neuroendocrine tumors and with associated with somatostatin receptors. So there it can have a trace somatostatin receptors. So the another important thing you should remember is the newer radiotracer. So this is a DOTA talk where the duodenal lesion is seen densely enhancing corresponding with the associated involvement of the duodenal segment. So still, it is not completely narrowed. So probably in future, it can be leading as neuroendocrine tumors are very notorious. So this is a normal area of the FDG, same patient, you have FDG, you have liver, you have spleen, but here in DOTA, in DOTA you are having a significant amount of uptake in the spleen and both kidneys and urinary bladder. So this is one of the example where PSMA is being used. You have prostate specific membrane antigen, 62 years prostatectomy, post radiotherapy, then PET CT PSMA showing extensive activity, which is seen in the multiple bones, disseminated metastasis is seen, involvement of the even the urinary bladder with the left inguinal node. So another one which is a radiotracer coming is FLT. So FLT is also a thymidine nucleoside where it can be used for trace tumor or proliferation. So you have another most commonly used as a radiotracer for the sodium fluoride in the bone scans. So this is not a routine nuclear bone scan or gamma gamma bone scan. This is a PET bone scan where 18 fluorine sodium fluoride is being used for the bone metabolism and most important related with the skeletal sclerotic metastasis. So you have 18 fluorine here. As I told you, it is a backbone of PET radiochemistry. It is produced in a cyclotron where nuclear reactions between oxygen, which is enriched water, bombarded with protons, releasing a neutron according to the aforementioned production equation is there. So you have a 1668 gallium where decay product of germanium can be there, and you have column material in the generator with a high yield of the daughter isotope. So this is pertaining to 18 fluorine. Again, it has a very long half-life of 110 minutes. Synthesis and studies can be extended over hours and transferred to distant centers. And it is having low positron energy of 640 kV, short tissue range of 2.3 millimeter, relatively higher resolution and low radiation doses for 18F synthesis, which is a high radioactive quantity in terms of curies. And thus 18F has advantage over the short-lived radioisotopes in rendering metabolite and plasma analysis needed for quantification and dynamic studies, which are possible. So with this, I have covered the basis. So for a recap, you have PET, you have CT, positron emission tomography and computed tomography, hybrid imaging, molecular imaging modality. You have CT detectors, but you have PET scintillators. LSO is the most commonly used scintillator, and avalanche photodiodes is more commonly used nowadays as compared to the photomultiplier tubes, which was used in the previous PET scans. So their detectors are detecting the energy in a form of Einstein's principle, 180 degrees, and then the energy is being picked up after injection from the patient's scintillators and the uncorrected image is formed. So uncorrected image, you have to fuse with the CT image, and CT acts as a attenuation correction factor. So uncorrected image is being converted into corrected image of the PET. So that is a process of formation. Then we have seen the metabolic activities, different metabolisms in the body, different aspects, different radiotracers based on the different pathologies. So that is another aspect in relation with the patient, patient preparation, and the formation of the radiotracers in the cyclotron. So hope this is a short, concise aspect which I tried to cover in the PET basics. Hope I think I have made it more little simplified. So with this, I thank you, Dr. Amar, once again, and I conclude my session. Thank you all for your kind attention.
Thank you, Sikandar sir, for that wonderful session. I had a question. Is there a particular SUV limit above which we will be concerned about malignancy? Because from my limited understanding, and positive, like an SUV uptake or just means that there is activity. It can be due to infection or any other pathology. But is there any threshold above which we can be, say, more sure about this being a malignancy versus a benign pathology?
I think there are a lot of literature available, but what we follow is more likely like above 4 SUV max of 4 and above is more likely to be the metabolically active. I'm using that word metabolically active because previously we used to call it malignant. But nowadays, because of a lot of non-oncological applications in tuberculosis or like concurrent two pathologies which are existing along with the malignancy, like tuberculosis, you have other collagen disorders, sarcoid or anything, other causes also. There is always an overlap. But above 4, we label it metabolically active. Definitely, it is metabolically active. But the another question now comes is whether it is infective or malignant. Now, we have to do a delayed scan after 1 hour or probably 2 hours in a sequential manner. If the standardized uptake value, SUV value is falling down, then it goes more in a favor of infection, tuberculosis, or any sarcoidosis, or any other non-malignant causes. But on contrary, if there is a persistent same SUV max or is increasing, then it goes more in a favor of malignancy. And the basic concept is here is malignant cells have more metabolic activity as compared to the infection, tuberculosis, or anything. But still, there is some overlap of 10 to 15% of gray areas, like you have aggressive fungal pathology versus malignancy. So you cannot differentiate. That is one of the limitation of the plant.
And sorry, after how many, say, hours or minutes do you do the delayed study?
Delay, ideally, after, like, protocol-wise, you are supposed to do 1 hour. For example, I finished study, PET study, I finished at 8 o'clock. Then I had to do at 9 o'clock, then 10 o'clock. Because not necessarily within 1 hour, you can see the difference. Because the more the closer the difference, like invasive fungal versus malignancy, then you have to go for a second hour. But most of the time, we try to get it and we try to give the answer.
So PET CT and nuclear medicine has come a long way since, like I've seen recently, there are a lot of diagnostic applications as well. So what are like the two more, say, top three common applications of for treatment, where nuclear medicine is used for treatment? Are there any upcoming treatment options which are, say, better than invasive surgeries or chemotherapy?
I think not related with the PET, but definitely with the nuclear, you have a thyroid ablations. So that is where we are using more commonly for the thyroid malignancies, where you can ablate it and then you can do it. So that is has come long way, and probably that is better than a chemo or any sort of surgery or any other form of a management plan.
Sounds good. I think that was it. And thank you for your excellent talk. And hopefully the residents will have learned at least the basics in a span of 40 minutes. It's difficult to cover such a vast topic. And if you have, for the viewers, if you have any questions or if you would want any further topics on nuclear medicine, do let us know via email, and then we'll try to request Dr. Sikandar once again to cover that specific topic. You'll also get a review feedback email. So do let us know how we did. If you like the video, hit the like button and subscribe to the RadioGyan YouTube channel. We do these sessions every Saturday at 8 p.m. India time and 10:30 a.m. Eastern time. So thank you everyone for joining us live today. And even for those who are watching us later, thank you. And do let us know your feedback and suggestions. And thank you, Dr. Sikandar, once again.
Yeah, bye-bye. Thank you all attendees.